735, 92.1 WROI, WROIFM.com. We are streaming audio live, RTC Channel 5, and we're soon to have audio and video on RTC Channel 4. That's why Scott and Steve are here today. Gentlemen, good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Nice to have you back with us.
Good to be here.
You have regular attendance now, Scott. That's right.
Back in rhythm.
I think so. Your own coffee cup, you're all set, ready to go. Absolutely. Time now for the Community Foundation Show. Brian Johnson is here. Hey, Brian, how you doing?
Good morning, Tom.
Good morning.
It's slightly damp out there. Less humid, less
bit,
heat.
A little bit of precipitation.
Is this like a fall preview for us?
Not quite yet.
Okay.
We're going to warm it up over the Labor Day holiday for you.
Okay. Well, yeah. that'll be a good time to get out on the lake.
Absolutely.
Enjoy some of that and other activities. So, well, good. Well, it was a nice walk down this morning. From our new office.
You're right, Ninth Street.
Just a reminder, if you haven't seen the sign or haven't been past our office, we're now at 227 East 9th Street, right here in Rochester. So stop in, say hi to us. One thing I have that I wanted to invite everyone to come to is the Fulton County Chamber of Commerce. We're hosting the Business After Hours this coming month in September, on the 13th of September. So that's a couple Thursdays away from now, from 4:30 to 6:30. Again, that'll be at our office, 227 East 9th Street. We'd love for folks to come out and stop by, have a snack. We'll have some delicious snacks from some local restaurants that you can partake of. Come see the new building. Come find out some of the things we've been doing over the past year. So
new facility serving you well, I assume?
It is. It's worked out really well.
Good.
A very good fit for our organization and has worked really well. So we're very appreciative of having the opportunity, and it's worked out very well. Probably better than we could have planned to start with. So
perfect.
So wonderful. So again, that's September 13th, from 4:30 to 6:30, at our office. So, stop by. A couple of things. Last month we talked about the Lilly application being available.
We did.
This month it's a reminder that that is due. If students are working on that, they have until next Tuesday, September 4th, to get everything completed on that. We would love to see your applications on that. If you have questions, don't hesitate to give us a call. We're more than willing to help with that. But I'd encourage students, make sure that everything is completed on that so that you're eligible for that process. If you have questions, don't hesitate to give us a call. Allison Heidi is our scholarship coordinator. She can work you through the process, whether you have questions about information that's required or maybe having trouble with pieces of information. We'll try and help however we can. So, but again, that deadline is September 4th, so you have a little bit less than a week to get that done. A couple of other things I wanted to talk about. Of course, school has started. One thing that we've been fortunate to be able to do over the past 5 years and continue again this year is preschool scholarships. We've had parents coming in the last week or so looking for information on that.
Those are more and more popular, aren't they?
They are. Yeah. They are. And we have more opportunities this year. Last year, we struggled to find some places for kids to land in a preschool, just space availability. This year, we have more options. We have the local preschools that we've always had, but also Rochester Schools has been able to open a preschool class and actually working on opening a second class. And so we've been fortunate to have some more opportunities for students that may not have been able to get into a class in the past. So these scholarships are available for the pre-K students. So the idea is that year before they go into kindergarten, whether that be a 4 or 5 year old, and we help with financial aspects of that. So if you're interested in that, or have need of that, if that's a barrier for being able to send your child to preschool, we'd love to talk to you about that. The preschools in the area have information. They actually had the applications. If you need help finding a preschool, we can point you in the direction of some that we know of in the area. But we'd love to, if the financial burden is part of the reason why students may not be going to preschool, we'd love to be able to help with that.
Excellent.
So So don't hesitate to give us a call, check out our website, stop by our office if you have questions about that. So one of the funds that we have that recently awarded some grants is the Kewaunee Union Township Endowment Fund. That's a fund that grants for projects specifically in the Union Township area. This year, the fund made three grants, one to the Kewaunee Library for $500. They do a lot of programming over at the library, and they were having trouble being heard, I guess would be the best way. So this allowed them to buy a portable sound system that they can take around, whether they have a program in a specific part of the library or outside. The library does a lot of programming over there, so this grant was for $500, allowed them to purchase a portable sound system and wireless microphone that they can use during these programs. The Kewaunee Youth League, of course, that was revitalized. This year, it's been a few years since they've had something over there, started it, had over 50 players involved in the first year coming back. So the fund granted $600 to help. They needed to replace some equipment, you let stuff sit for a while and it wears out. And so that helped them replace some of the equipment that they've needed. And then also the Kewaunee Community Food Pantry. They've expanded quite a bit in recent years, and they needed some space for an additional freezer. So the fund granted them $1,000 to help purchase an additional freezer that'll allow them to serve some more perishable goods and meat products to their clients. So wonderful to see how that fund has supported the community.
Good.
And one last grant application that we have available. This is a new application that we've not offered before, but health and wellness grants. We have two funds, the Brent L. Blacketer Memorial Fund, which was set up in memory of Brent by Mabel Blacketer, and then the Hope Hospice Legacy Fund. Of course, Hope Hospice was in our community for a number of years when that organization transitioned to a new organization. We weren't able to grant to the new organization, so what we did was model the fund after the Brent Blacketer Fund, and it's for organizations that are providing some sort of health and wellness programs in our community. We have an application on our website, nicf.org. The deadline for that is October 1st. So if you're an organization that's providing something along those lines, we'd encourage you to check that out. If you have questions about that, let us know. But it's wonderful to see two names carried on in our community making an impact. Hope Hospice was such a huge part of our community for that tradition to be carried on, and then also the Blacketer name, Brent Blacketer, to be able to help support these needs in our community that are just really growing. I don't think a day goes by where we don't hear something about health or wellness or mental health or things like that that impact our community on a daily basis. So it's wonderful to see those supported. So
excellent.
So those are some of the current events that we have going on. Today we have with us Larry,
the star of the show,
Larry Cunningham. Larry, welcome.
Thank you.
Of course, Larry has been involved with the Fulton County Community Foundation since 2006, but his history with community foundations goes way beyond that. So this is actually Larry's 12th year on the Fulton County Board, and unfortunately we have these things called term limits. And so we're going to lose Larry as a board member. He's going to stay on as an advisor. But I wanted to invite Larry today because he has a rich history with community foundations. And if you need a pep talk, talk to Larry.
Because
I never walk out of a conversation with Larry depressed or sad. I always feel encouraged. So with that, Larry, I guess My first question is, tell us maybe how you got involved in community foundations.
Well, it started back in 1993, I believe, when they first started looking at the foundations. And I was director of a library in Jennings County and wanted to get involved. Well, I found out the library could not participate in the community foundations at that time, so we had to have a change of law. But I felt that the community foundation had great opportunities for us in our community. It was a real challenge. We didn't have a lot of major industry, and we had to raise $1 million, and we did it with $200, $350 donations, reached that goal. And as I look at it, it's a a foundation that looks to the needs of the local community, and felt that that was what you needed to do.
Right.
And the fact that it was the monies were sacred, that only you spent the earnings from that endowment fund. So that meant that that money would be giving forever. I don't think you can find a better deal in anywhere. And particularly when you're looking now, and you're looking at August, and you're beginning to look at your tax planning, if you're a large organization, look at that as a possibility at the end. Talk to your accountant or to your advisors about it to say, hey, I've got a tax bill of X. If I give the foundation X amount of money, does that reduce my tax bill? And see how you can use that to benefit the local community. You get the full bang, you leave it here. You get less if you send it off, and just a few cents come back. So we looked at that as a major advantage of looking at the how to leverage your funding locally.
Okay.
I think the other thing the foundation does is it does provide leverage for funds. A lot of times you have to go out for grants, and they say, well, do you have some funds to seed that thing? And we can go to the foundation, and oftentimes they can provide that bridge to get the major grant that you're looking for. I think the other thing that you have to look at, and particularly when we look at Fulton County, it is a county-wide foundation, not Rochester, county-wide. And we have given funds all over the county, and you drive through the communities, and you see the benefits. Oftentimes, you'll see a sign that says funds provided by the community foundation, and occasionally we put the signs up. But everywhere you look, you're going to find the community foundation involved in your local community, whether it be the community buildings or, in our case in Kiwanis, was a handicap ramp to the Hardery. So you find that the community foundation is about everywhere. The thing I like, again, is that I trust our local people to make decisions about how to use that money. And I had a fund set up. It was an agency fund, and I decided to make it a community fund, saying, well, when I'm dead, someone's got to make decisions about it, so why not start now and sure. Let them make decisions as to where those funds ought to be used and where it would benefit the community the best. And so we switched it to a community fund. So I think it's very important that we do this. I had been involved in the Fulton County Community Foundation. I was moving from Columbus, Indiana to Fulton County, and I was on the road between 25 and Rochester. I heard a radio ad about the Community Foundation, the 4-H Fund. And I thought, I wonder where that office is. So I drove into Rochester, I found it, and said, look, the 4-H was a very important part of my life as a student here, so let's make a significant donation and help get that started. So that's how I got involved with the local foundation. And again, I couldn't find a more rewarding activity than working with the community foundation. And you can't find a better staff in the whole world than what we have here in Fulton County. They
Excellent.
All work together, they promote the community, and every time you go in, it's a pleasure. I mean, you just feel good about what the community foundation does. I know attending the board meetings, working with committees, there's not been a day that I have come to town and not felt really great when I left, because we were always looking at what can we do for the community now and in the future. And that is a great, great asset to the community. So that's where we come from in looking at the community foundation. And I think it's great, great benefit.
You already answered my first two questions, Larry. but I guess I'd be kind of curious, give us some feedback on some of the favorite things that you think the foundation has been involved in your time on the board.
Well, I think that the one of the major things are the community buildings in the townships. When our schools left, many of the townships, you left a big hole. There was not a center for which the community would organize around. And these community buildings provide that center now. Of course, if they've got a library, I know that's the right one. By having these community centers, it's a great benefit. We use them a lot in organizations I've been involved in, and there's such a tremendous benefit. I think the other thing is, of course, being from the Kiwanis area, is the food pantry. It used to be upstairs in the church building. You had to carry the food upstairs, and you had to carry the food downstairs. And if you look at most of these church activities, there are a lot of cotton heads involved. Older people.
Right.
But walking up and down those stairs was a real problem. We had the opportunity for a building that was ground floor, one floor. That was a major, major benefit to say to Kiwanis. So I think that's very important. Now, I'm also in charge of the vice at the Hardery. I'm vice president. I mean, not vice, but... But we had the building, and there's steps. Well, we got a grant to put in a ramp. You get a ramp, then you say, well, look, gee, we got the handicapped people in, but we have no facilities for them. And so we got another grant to provide, to put those facilities in. So that's the kind of thing that it does, the foundation. It provides the opportunities to improve things so that more people can benefit from their community. So it's just, there's no better investment. There's no better investment in the world.
And you haven't mentioned it. I know you've been part of our scholarship committee. So tell us maybe a little bit about that experience.
Yeah, if you've never served on the scholarship committee, you should. There is no better way to make you feel better about the community. You hear all kinds of things about the kids are not good enough today. They're lazy. They're this. They're that. But you go through and read those scholarship applications, and you just got to be, how do they do it?
Right.
How do they do it? Yeah. I'm always amazed at how many of the kids that were homeless that are applying for scholarships. And you say, here, they're working, they're going to school, they're keeping the GPA up, and they're qualifying for scholarships. How do they do it? And I always say to the people who want to gripe about it, visit the school.
Exactly.
The last time, you know, I've argued with people on this, when was the last time you were at school? Well, I graduated in 1943. Well, that doesn't count today. You better go out and talk to the kids. Right. I spend a lot of time as a librarian, one day or 2 days a week, talking to classes or helping with research projects. And I never found bad kids. Sometimes I found bored kids. Because our society is moving so fast, the technology is moving so fast, now we're beginning to bring that technology into the classroom. But if you want to feel good about your community and its future, serve on one of the scholarship committees.
Okay.
Your heart breaks when you realize that you don't have enough money to give everybody a scholarship.
Right.
And you have to make decisions. And you say, gee, if I were a multimillionaire or a billionaire, I would take care of all of them because they all deserve it. But you have to make decisions, and they're hard. But again, there is no greater joy than going through those scholarship applications and see what dedicated kids we have and what the leadership of tomorrow will be is right there in our hands when we read them.
Perfect.
I just find it's a wonderful experience.
Well said, Larry.
And you mentioned a little bit about grants. I know one of the things that we've recently done is expanded it so there's no deadlines. Talk a little bit about your involvement with the Grants Committee and how you've seen some things evolve with that.
Well, I think it's great that we have this kind of a floating grant application because we can meet immediate needs then. That is, if we have funds available. That's always an issue that you have a limited number of funds available. But I think when you look at the grants, and there's another one that's really hard to, you know, you read the grant, you say, hey, this really needs it, but we don't have the funds to completely operate it, but we can give partial. Sometimes we'll have to look and say, well, we think this is the most important part of that application, let's fund it. But again, if you look at the organizations and the applications and what they're doing, they're improving every day. That's the one thing. We see the applications are improving, and we learned from that. Oftentimes an application come in, we say, look, we think they really need to do more work to plan for it. We need to see a little more detail. And we do visit the locations now when they do ask for a grant. That has been a very helpful thing to the organization and to the foundation. Oftentimes we can go and say, well, I think you believe this is the most important thing, but from our observation, we think X is more important. And so we can give a little guidance and also provide a better application when they do come back in. The other thing that often happens with these grants, you try to encourage them, say, if you don't get the full funding, or if you don't get the grant this time, apply again. But if you go to the library and look what the grants computer program we have, you may find another source, and you already have the information. And so don't give up. Look other places. And so you never give up.
Right.
You keep working on it, and you come back. And then we may see a different need, or there may be, when we look at the group, yours may come to the top where it didn't come to the top in the last go-around. So, and again, it's open at any time you can apply. And then we have quarterly meetings to review these and to see what we can do, if we have the funding or what we're going to do, or we can say, hey, maybe you need to change that grant to an impact grant rather than a community grant. So we do give advice and do give help to the organization to make sure they can meet the needs.
Okay.
Again, it is one of those things when you serve on the committee, you realize that there are a great many needs out in the community that you may not even know about, or you know about and you just wish they would do something. And this is the opportunity to come to the Community Foundation and ask for help. And so it's, again, there's no better joy than looking at scholarships and grants and providing funds that, that boost the community. That's all. That's what it's all about.
Brian, you're going to miss him.
We are going to miss him. That's why we try and keep him involved as much as we can. So,
exactly.
So kind of as we wrap up, Larry, any final thoughts?
Again, if you're not familiar with the Community Foundation, do stop into the office. You can't miss it. They got this beautiful sign right out in front of it. And you can go after you have your discussion, go over to the bagel shop and have a bite. Again, look to the NICF org. There's an opportunity to donate on a monthly basis. Provide the funds. I always think that, I used to get paid to go to board meetings. Now I feel that I have an obligation to pay them for attending the meeting. And so any amount from $5 sure. to $100 a month or whatever you want to provide, it is an investment in your own community, in your own children, and your own grandchildren. So think of us every day.
Okay.
Well, on behalf of the foundation, we've enjoyed having you on the board. Thank you from the community because all the things that you've done. We're still working on getting Larry to show some enthusiasm about the foundation. if you can't hear that in his voice, he not many bigger cheerleaders right. of the foundation. So, Larry, thank you for all the service that you've provided. We've appreciated having you involved.
Well, you couldn't ask for a better staff to work with the community and the Community Foundation. They've just been a wonderful experience, and I hope to keep a relationship for years to come.
Excellent. We do too. So, well, just a quick reminder about a few things. Of course, the Lilly Scholarship application due September 4th, coming right up. Preschool applications are available. Our business after hours coming up on September 13th from 4:30 to 6:30. And also the health and wellness grant application, that deadline is October 1st. You can find information about all that on our website, nicf.org. Find us on Facebook under Northern Indiana Community Foundation. Give us a call here in Rochester, 224-3223, or stop by our new office at 227 East 9th Street. We'd love to talk to you about any questions or ideas you may have for the community.
Brian Johnson, Larry Cunningham, hey, thanks, gentlemen, for all the good work you do for Fulton County.
Thank you, Tom.
Much appreciated.
Thank you, Tom.